Greetings, everyone, and welcome. I'm the Chancellor of Soul, Mike Boone, and you've tuned in to another edition of Soul Facts, a show highlighting the history and music of legendary artists and preserving their legacy. Ray Charles, the High Priest of Soul. Sam Cooke, the Prince of Soul. James Brown, the Godfather of Soul. Miss Aretha Franklin, the Queen of Soul. You know, much credibility has been given to these legendary artists as the founders of R&B Soul, and well-deserving. But I would like to examine the real credibility of those who are truly responsible for the genesis of R&B music. As some music historians continue to erase R&B's true proclamation and share misguided opinionated information to diehard music lovers, I would like to honor the significant artists who defined and shaped the origins of R&B soul music. One of those early pioneers of such was a gentleman from Memphis, Tennessee named John Marshall Alexander Jr., better known to the music world as the one and only Johnny Ace. Born June 9, 1929 to the Reverend and Mrs. John Alexander, for one of 11 children, Johnny Ace attended LaRose Grammar School on the south side of Memphis, where he learned to play the piano and take part in the school choir. His doting but strict mother, Leslie Alexander, began to take notice of Johnny's extraordinary talent and financed his music and art lessons. At 17, Ace disappointed his parents when he dropped out of Booker T. Washington High School during his junior year. He then joined the Navy, where he later was discharged because of his lack of maturity and irresponsibility. Afterwards, Johnny returned to Memphis, began hanging around the Mitchell Hotel, and soon joined B.B. King's band as a pianist.
Now it is 3 o'clock in the morning.
After B.B. hit with 3 O'Clock Blues, King formed his own band and left for Los Angeles. Ace soon took over B.B.'s WDIA radio show and his former band and renamed them the Beale Streeters.
Can't even close my eyes.
Ace's personal life was not without turmoil. He married a ninth grader named Lois Jean Palmer and had impregnated her with a son. Johnny's parents took mother and son into their home, but he was not welcome to stay. Shortly, Ace's music career took a solo turn when David James Mathis, WDIA program director and DJ and founder of Duke Records, was set to record Bobby Blue Bland. Bland fouled up the session because he couldn't read and didn't take time to learn the lyrics of the songs. With studio time left, Johnny was called to fill in for Bland after Dave Mathis heard him messing around on the piano with a Ruth Brown song entitled So Long.
So long. Oh, we'll meet again someday.
The song inspired Ace, along with Mathis, to compose a tune by changing the melody from Brown's song, adding lyrics, and titled it My Song on Mathis's Duke imprint.
For me, that you would leave me here in tears. But now you're gone and hours seem like years. Darling, I sing my song.
Around this time, Dave Mathers, Christian John Alexander as Johnny Ace, by taking the first name of the famous pop crooner, Johnny Ray, and the last name of the 50s group, the Four Aces, by deleting the S and shortening the name to Ace.
Now I'm wondering, where did you go?
Now a star is born.
Please tell me what is wrong.
With tenor saxophonist Adolph Billy Duncan, My Song zoomed to popularity status, where it was in demand by the public and independent record distributors, placing an order of 53,000 platters before sales. When delivering the stock to each of the companies, Mathers was financially cheated by the distributors, who refused to pay.
So darling, I sing my song.
So, with a hot new commodity on his hands, and in fear of going broke, Dave Mathers struck up a deal with record entrepreneur Don Roby in July of 1952. Roby, founder of Peacock Records in Houston, Texas, named his label after his nightclub, the Bronze Peacock Dinner Club. Mathers' main purpose for the deal was not only to gain airplay for My Song, but to get Johnny Ace better promotion, knowing that Roby had the muscle to do so.
I still love you. Won't you please come back to me?
My Song hit number one for 9 weeks straight on the R&B charts.
Don't stay from me, 'cause you'll always be my own. We'll be together for eternity.
After the success of My Song, Don Roby, with gun in tow, gained full control of David Mathers' Duke imprint in April 1953, reportedly for $10,000 or more. Now in charge, Roby took control of the artist's contracts and publishings and forged his name as Dietrich Malone as full or co-writer of any of the compositions written by the artist. His Peacock label was used as a subsidiary for all future Duke releases.
If you need me, please let me know.
The smooth baritone vocals and gifted songwriting abilities of Johnny Ace not only attracted female admirers and put their emotions in a tailspin with his flair of debonair, meanwhile was setting a trend in the genesis of R&B music. Ace also suffered a case of stage fright. Instead of using the regulated center stage microphone, Johnny shied away in the background and sang with his piano only.
You know when you left me, you broke my poor heart.
Along with My Song, Johnny Ace charted 6 top 10 hits from 1952 to 1953, starting with
I Cross My Heart.
Cross My Heart.
I hope to die if I should ever make you cry. I look at the face,
the clock
of the clock on the wall, and it doesn't tell nothing at all.
Saving My Love for You.
I'm saving my love for you. Please forgive me.
Please forgive me.
I've been wrong all my life. Please forgive me. I just want to do right. My darling.
And never let me go.
And never let me go.
By now, Johnny Ace was named Most Program Artist by Cash Magazine in 1954. including numerous awards.
No tears, no sorrow.
Johnny Ace's career boomeranged way into the stratosphere of a multiple musical constellation. But through this beautiful, vast sea of illumination, Ace's shining star will slowly begin to dim.